Hello everyone, welcome. Thank you all so much for joining us this afternoon. My name's Malaika, I'm editor of Crafts Magazine. This is the very final talk in what's been a really brilliant series of discussions over the last few days hosted by Collect International Art Fair for Contemporary Craft in conjunction with the magazine. We've had our minds expanded and our spirits lifted over the last few days. And hopefully we'll now go out with a bang. The fair continues on artsy.net until the 24th of March. So you've still got masses of time to while away the hours enjoying all the incredible artworks that are on the fair's online portal. There are works from all over the world and everything is available to buy. A lot of the work's been created in the last 12 months. So it's in this kind of extraordinary time that we've been living through. So it's inflected by this moment of change in a really positive way. The seeds for this talk tonight were planted in our January-February issue when we invited the cultural strategist, Tom Fleming, to write an opinion piece with the same title. Can craft save our cities? Our high streets were already in trouble before the pandemic hit, and now the change seems pretty irreversible. So we asked him to look at what role artists and specifically makers could play in rejuvenating our city centres, bringing life back to them, and also creating positive change, you know, creating spaces that are enriching and welcoming and inclusive, and also that have community at their hearts. One of the things that I think is especially unique about makers is that they often bring with them kind of ecosystems of collaborators, and they offer services like workshops and repair facilities, etc. So there's something really special there. We brought together a panel this afternoon who can shed light on this subject in completely different ways. We have Chenine Bhathena, Morag Myerscough, and Caitlin Warfield with us tonight. I'm going to let Annie fully introduce them, but I will introduce Annie herself, Annie Warburton, who's chairing the talk. She is CEO of Cockpit Arts, which is London's leading studio provider for makers and designers. And it's also a social enterprise which nurtures creative talent. Some of the discussion today is going to feed into our place issue, which is going to be our July-August issue. It's going to look at craft's role in a post-pandemic world and what it is that, and also how makers can shape the spaces we inhabit. So if you are a maker or an artist or a designer or even a curator working on a project that you think would be really relevant to that, to this discussion and to this issue, do get in touch with us. You can reach us on crafts@craftscouncil.org.uk. We'd love to hear from you, as always. This talk coincides with the launch of our March-April issue. It explores the notion of movement in lots of different ways. It's something that we all took for granted before the pandemic ground us to a halt and literally confined us to our homes. Our cover artist, for example, is a textile artist who's extremely colourful, vibrant and dreamlike works look at migration and the movement of people and what it means to be born into a diaspora. Other interpretations of movement include, we have a piece on the making of a giant puppet performance piece that's going to make its way across Europe later this year as a sort of emblem of the refugee experience. And we have a piece on the art of bespoke bicycle making. And then the issue also incorporates our pick of the very finest from Collect Art Fair. And it incorporates the catalogue itself, which is the kind of analogue physical way to experience this year's fair. And it's a kind of keepsake as well. You can buy the issue on our website and subscribe that way on the Crafts Council's website. Annie and her panelists are now going to speak for 45 minutes or so, and then there'll be plenty of time to ask questions at the end. So do put your questions, if you have some, in the Q&A box at the bottom of your Zoom screen. Thank you very much. Over to you, Annie.
Thank you so much, Malaika, and thank you for the opportunity to host this talk. I'm absolutely delighted to be here. I'm going to say a few words by way of introduction before I then introduce our panel and hand over to them. So long before the pandemic arrived, our high streets were in existential meltdown. Chains were moving out, betting shops moving in, and independents were long gone. So as the Chancellor gears up to present what's been a very well-trailed rescue package for retail and hospitality tomorrow, what can culture and specifically craft do to re-enliven our beleaguered city centres? That's the topic for today. So for some, makers are in the vanguard of an urban renaissance, the handmade high street. In this vision, as we continue to outsource shopping to online out-of-town distributors, our long-suffering city centres will be repopulated by maker spaces, studios, independent bespoke stores, and a thriving experience economy. The pandemic in this view, and that's the view of Tom Fleming, for example, has merely accelerated trends that were already on their way. But before we delve deeply into the question of makers as placemakers, I'd like to debunk a couple of myths. First is the myth in the popular imagination that craft is a rural pursuit, one that's irrelevant, hipsters aside, to contemporary urban professional life. Actually, our cities are already filled with makers. Indeed, the very street names celebrate that heritage of making. We have Weaver Row, for example, or as you can see in the slide, Crafted Leather Lane. And if we think of that bastion of our monetary system, the Bank of England, it's located on Thread Needle Street. So craft is in the very texture of our streets. And indeed, you know, as CEO at Cockpit Arts, we're home to over 150 makers practicing in more than 20 different disciplines and supporting a wider ecology of 300 jobs. So craft is alive and very much thriving in our urban environments. But I said I'd debunk two myths. The second is that craft could be a quick fix for the high street. At Cockpit, we have about once a month someone knocking on our door, a local authority or a developer, asking us whether we would like to take over an unused ground floor space. They're looking for instant craft, character, and community. But of course, a meaningful community takes time to develop. And it's not just a case of sprinkling a blacksmith or two among the coffee chains. So the question we're going to get to grips with our amazing panel is, are we really on our way to what Tom calls a post-COVID urban economy that's more diverse, distinctive, and crafted? Or is that just all so much breathless utopianism? Well, that's no small question. So fortunately, we have a panel of experts with us to illustrate how craft is indeed transforming the urban environment. Here to discuss the topic are cultural strategist Chenine Bhathena, who's creative director of Coventry 2021 UK City of Culture, artist, designer and maker Morag Myerscough, and Caitlin Warfield of Brookfield Properties, a developer that has a profound commitment to craft. Over the next hour, we'll unpack this question of how makers and galleries are bringing texture and soul back to our streets. We're going to kick off by hearing from each of our panelists in turn, and they'll walk us through some projects. Then we'll bring all the panel back together for a discussion. And I'm eager to make this as interactive as possible. So please do post your questions in the Q&A box, and I'll come back to as many of those as possible. So first off, it's my great pleasure to introduce Chenine Bhathena. As I said, Chenine is Creative Director of the Coventry City of Culture Trust. She's leading the creative programme for the UK's third City of Culture, which will run for 12 months starting on the 15th of May. Chenine has a brilliant background in culture and placemaking. She's worked with artists across all genres throughout her career. Since London 2012, when she designed and delivered the biggest festival of art set against the landscape of the city, she's focused her energy on leading programmes that show the value of arts and culture in placemaking. Chenine joins us today as Coventry has made its second major programme announcement revealed this morning and hot off the press. Chenine, over to you.
Thanks so much, Annie, and hi everyone. It's so lovely to be here with you today. I just wanted to say a few words before I run through my slides. Coventry has a rich heritage in craft. It was built by craftsmen back in medieval times, and all around the city you can see the heritage of craft, whether you're looking at the industries that have grown up in the city around bicycles and cars, watches and ribbons, the blue dye that came from the wonderful ingredients that we found in our river. We've still got the guilds that operate and that are alive in the city today, and you can still see top shops all over the city, the homes of so much creativity through the craft revolution. I suppose I just wanted to talk a little bit today about how we're trying to work with artists and makers through the City of Culture year. And my first slide really, it shows a picture of a wonderful playground that's been created and designed by Ivan Morrison and Heather Morrison from Studio Morrison. And really, I wanted to talk really about how we're trying to put a creative signature right through the foundations of our city so that it really brings our places to life and it injects energy into them and makes them really playful. And it's, I suppose, the playground analogy really, for me, it talks about playful cities. We know how hard artists work, that they really can connect with people. They solve problems. They address the things that are staring us in the face. They bring imagination, vitality, and escapism. And the work that they create creates a buzz and really contributes to our health and well-being. So in my mind, it's absolutely vital that when we're planning and designing our cities, we must work with artists and makers. And this is a great project that we worked with the City Council on, really to show that how you can take a very practical intervention in the city and you can bring artists and designers in to do something special and creative and imaginative with it, which in turn delivers imagination to the people that use it. Just moving on to my second slide, I just had a slide here of a shop window in Coventry. This used to be a fish and chip shop, and it was given over to a theatre company in the city called Theatre Absolute. And before Christmas, we trialled a new project called the Show Windows, and really kind of looking at how we put community and maker culture right at the centre of city revival. And so across our city centres and our high streets and our shopping precincts, there are rows and rows of shop windows, the everyday galleries, windows into an imagination, spaces looking to be transformed. And so many shops and retailers struggle to get people over their thresholds. Annie mentioned it earlier. But how incredible when makers and artists can take over these shop windows, work with the business owners, work with communities to really build and create the imagination in those windows. We see it at Christmas across our high streets. We see windows transformed with light and Christmas montages. But all year round, there's a place for artists to create some mischief and to invite people to stare in and see some of the wonderful craft and art culture that's alive and kicking in our cities. And thirdly, I just wanted to share a photo of a piece of artwork that's in one of the window panes of Coventry Cathedral. It's called The Broken Angel. And John Hutton, back in when we were building the new Coventry Cathedral back in the 60s, he created this incredible scene in this west screen window. But sadly, in the early part of 2020, the window was smashed, a real act of destruction. And I suppose drawing on the themes of brokenness and reconstruction that really helped us to think about the building of the new Coventry Cathedral, an extraordinary building full of art and craft, really thinking about how can we take that window and do something really important with it, turn it into a revolving artwork created by makers, thinking differently about destruction and the reconstruction of space and place. And so this project is going to be opening at the Coventry Cathedral in the autumn. I hope you'll come and see it. But really, it's about how we reconstruct craft in modern environments around our city. So just to finish for me, just to say, I suppose all three of these projects, for me, they show how community art and maker culture, working with a range of interesting materials and a dose of playful imagination, can really help to create cities that people can enjoy living in and that create everyday acts of wonder. I'll hand back to Annie.
Thank you so much, Chenine. That's clearly just a scratch on the surface of the richness of the Coventry 2021 programme, but really inspiring with those three different examples. And you brought in some of my favourite words, playful, mischief and imagination, really inspiring words. You also touched on Coventry Cathedral, and actually that's what I wanted to ask you about, because the cathedral as a crafted post-war relic is the most astonishing symbol of hope and true regeneration, not cynical regeneration, but a resurrection, if you like, you know, but a rebirth and a symbol of agency and how we make our future. So Coventry was a symbol of hope post-war through the cathedral. Can Coventry do it again?
Well, I hope so. We are the Phoenix City. We did rise from the ashes after World War II. We were very badly blitzed in the Blitz. You know, the city was razed to the ground, and out of the ashes rose this incredible new Coventry Cathedral, you know, as you say, a masterpiece of art and craft and culture. And a place of culture now as well, a place that hosts so many different events, activities, and brings communities in from all parts of the city, not just Christian communities. You know, everyone has a space and a place here to come and be part of the city's heritage and renewal. And I think now with Coventry City of Culture and with the year that we've got coming ahead, we really see this year as a way to kickstart that renewal and the recovery that we all need. And I think the cathedral is a real guiding light in everything that we do. You know, we invented the Twin Cities concept back in the 1950s after World War II, extending a hand of friendship. And when we extended that hand of friendship, we extended it with a beautiful tapestry. So it was all done using craft and art. And we really hope that that's the way that we build those bridges with those communities that are suffering all over the world still through our year of culture.
Thank you, Chenine. I've actually got, I found that extraordinarily moving. I've got shivers as you were talking about that. So thank you so much. Well, of course, we'll bring you back in the conversation after we've heard from our other panelists. So I'm now going to introduce our second panelist, the artist, designer and maker, Morag Myerscough. Morag's mantra is, make happy those who are near and those who are far will come. She's one of the designers whose style last year Nathaniel Adam Furman characterised as New London Fabulous, which is just a fantastic description. Morag's work probably needs no introduction, but it's rooted in creating a sense of joy and belonging, two more of my favourite words, for all those who encounter it. Morag's fascinated by how colour, pattern and words can change urban environments and people's perceptions of spaces, transforming spaces into places. She creates structural installations and immersive spatial works that champion community and public interaction. Morag, over to you.
Hello, everybody. Thank you for that introduction. I do lots and lots of things, but because I've only got 3 minutes, I'm going to carry on from Coventry because I've been working in Coventry with Coventry, because obviously I wasn't able to go there very often for the last 15 months. And I was invited to Coventry in February to come and have a look. And I walked through the whole of Coventry, and you were just talking about the cathedral. And that day I wore a Kitty Joseph rainbow skirt, and I was walking through the city and people just kept on coming up to me going, oh, you're so colourful, it's so fantastic. And it was so welcoming and great. And then we went to the cathedral, and I'd never seen John Piper and Patrick Rainton's stained glass before, and it was just blew my mind. The colour was just fantastic, and the whole of the cathedral was just incredible, the craftsmanship. And that stayed in my mind over the last 15 months. And when I looked at lots of different places in Coventry to possibly do a project, but then it focused on this area, which is called Hertford Street, which, as mentioned before, Coventry was blitzed very badly, but this road was particularly blitzed. It's a historical street that's always gone through the city, but it was so badly blitzed, it was completely rebuilt. But it's an area of, like we were talking about, chains and shops that really you can see that isn't really very inviting anymore. And people don't go to this area so much. So I was asked to look at how I could think of how this could be changed or seen in a different way. And I am working on a two-phased project. So the first phase, if you go to the next image, please. Is actually this walk up through this canopied area. This was the first pedestrian area in Coventry, actually, for shopping. And I wanted to change people's visions of entering from the Bull Yard through into Broadgate, through Hertford Street. And just, I'm often brought in, I do a lot of temporary work, and I'm often brought in just to start changing people's perceptions of places, to look at it in a way they'd never seen it before. And in this instance, it was really important to bring lots of planting in and to really make the place feel like it was growing. And then there will be hopefully a second phase where, when you walk through Hertford Street, there's an area where the Empire Cinema is, and there's some lots of food kiosks. And we will work with local artists and to design the kiosks with the food the people who own the kiosks, I can't think of the word. So just change how the actual things on the ground are re-looked at. You don't want to just, it's not about just making colour and painting things. That won't do it. It's actually, like you were talking about, what will the shops be used for? How will that be rethought? And that's when change happens. But sometimes it has to go slowly. It can't, things take a while and they need to be embedded and they need to grow sort of almost organically. But you can kickstart, if you go to the next image, you can see, you can kickstart a change. And it's also about people showing that you care, that the council and the people around you are looking after the places that maybe sometimes have been forgotten a little bit, and can be, if somebody comes and has a new look at them, then it changes things. So I think that's all I want to say for this stage.
Fantastic. Thank you so much, Morag. I have a question, but actually I'm going to pause that question, bring it in later, because there's a question that's come in through the Q&A directly for you. So I'm going to read that one out, which is saying, Morag, your colour palette is amazing. How long do you envisage the vibrancy to last in the changes that you make, for example, in Hertford Street? Do you factor in a very practical question here, do you factor in a maintenance budget to keep the areas vibrant? So maybe there's a philosophical and a practical aspect to this. How do we make lasting change?
Okay, so this is the colour palette. This is actually the colour palette for the thing where I've been specified the paints. So I use exterior paint that lasts 15 years. And actually, that's the thing I wanted to say. It's really important that I work with local suppliers and also local craftspeople. So I won't be painting the artwork, but he's not based in Birmingham, but the sign painter Jim Carr, who is an expert sign painter, he will be doing painting it for me. And when I do work, I think it is really, really important that the money goes back, that you use local companies and the money goes back to the local people, rather than, you know, say, for example, me bringing loads of people from London and then you have to also pay for staying overnight, all that, you know, that sort of thing. So this piece of work has not necessarily said that it's a semi-permanent piece of work. You know, sometimes things, they tell you for 5 years and maybe it will last 10 years. But the principle of it is that you use materials and you paint it in such a way that the materials won't fade and they will last, and it's done in a really quality way. So and I also absolutely agree with you that I think that budgets need to be put for maintenance. I think maintenance is the biggest thing, because I was surprised to learn that canopy in the Hertford Street that I'm working in Coventry, I thought it was done in the 90s. And it was actually only done in 2012, you know, it's only remade. And because maintenance is really important and you have to keep that going. And I think that's a thing where sometimes that has been lost along the way, because things can remain beautiful even though they're old.
Absolutely.
Which, you know.
Yeah, so we can factor in and plan in for that long-term sustainability, and that's about sustainability. We're embedded in a local community as well as the practical, very important sustainability. So thank you so much for elaborating that so clearly, Morag. I'm going to invite in our third and final panelist, who is Caitlin Warfield. Caitlin is Vice President, Marketing and Arts at Brookfield Properties Europe. She oversees Brookfield Properties marketing and arts strategy, connecting the cultural and commercial world to enrich cities and the public realm. Brookfield says its mission is to present free, world-class cultural experiences to the public. And it sees its role as bringing public spaces to life through art. And it's been doing that for over three decades, bringing communities together around creativity by animating the public realm. So, Caitlin, over to you.
Thank you, Annie, and thank you to the Crafts Council so much for having me today on this talk. Really inspiring hearing to Morag and Chenine's pieces as well. I think if we could just to give a little overview of Brookfield, I think you said it well, Annie, we've had an arts program for about 30 years. It's something that's very integral to our business. We work with makers and artists in various different ways. One being on our development projects, and then also, you know, more temporary installations, really across the board. Here is a slide of a building that we acquired, and actually at last year's collect event when we were in person, my curator Saf Williams and I were walking through and saw these beautiful pieces by Margot Selby. And as we were redeveloping this lobby, we were like, you know, we have to have these and put these on the wall. They're beautiful. She's an incredible maker. And we worked with her to get these up. And I think we purchased them within two weeks of that collect event, which was pretty quick. But I think one of the things that we've really been doing with the Crafts Council that we've been really excited about is our Properties Crafts Council Collection Award. So we launched it last year. And if you go to the next slide.
Caitlin, can I just interrupt you? I'm sorry. I'm just getting a couple of messages to say that your sound is a bit low. So I don't know if that's,
I don't know. Is this any better?
That's better. Yes. Thank you. Thanks so much.
Of course. So just to jump back into this. So we work with the Crafts Council on a collection award. And as part of that, they help us curate an exhibition in one of our lobby spaces in London. In one of our lobby spaces. This is at 99 Bishopsgate in London. We own about 12 buildings in the city of London. So here we have Matt Smith. We purchased two pieces with him that we've donated to the Crafts Council collection, and we exhibited those as part of this. And then if the next slide is just another example of how we've put this into the space. We really offer cultural support to the benefit to the communities in which we serve. So I think especially now as cities have been hit so hard by the pandemic, we've really tried to stand by the cultural sector throughout lockdown through initiatives with the Crafts Council. So this we put on last year when we kind of had a break from lockdown, and we had a lot of people come through at that time. We have a lot of other cultural partnerships with Culture Mile, London Symphony Orchestra, and we'll continue to do so. We're very excited about this summer. So we really try to work collaboratively with cultural institutions to create experiences to enrich these communities in which we're located. So I think that's it.
Okay. Thank you so much, Caitlin. So I had the pleasure of sitting in on your presentation on the Brookfield Properties Crafts Council Collection Award on, I think it was Thursday night. And Matt is an amazing, amazing maker and artist. I remember when I was at the Crafts Council, I think I gave him two awards during collect. So he's, you know, absolutely phenomenal. I know that you've chosen another phenomenal maker for this year. Would you like to share that with our audience and tell us a bit about them?
Sure. So this year we're very excited. We're working with British textile artist Anna Ray. So we've acquired two of her pieces that we'll put on exhibition and will go into the Crafts Council collection. She's represented by House of Mars. We really think that her craft brings a sense of energy, joy, and reflection during lockdown. I believe the two pieces that we've acquired, she made during lockdown. So that's really exciting. They're really colorful and fantastic. So we're really excited to work with her and the Crafts Council again on the exhibition that'll come towards the end of summer, autumn of this year. Yeah, those are
fantastic.
The pieces.
And then, there we can see the work. I was thinking, it's very hard to describe. Well, all of this work is hard to describe verbally. And I remember showing some of Anna's work in Miami a few years ago, and I was trying to think of how to describe it. And I came up with lemon anemone last night when I was thinking about it. But she really is extraordinary and has that joyful essence that we're all needing so much. So it will be really exciting to see the exhibition as it comes forward later in the year. Yeah. So thank you for that, Caitlin. Yeah. I'm now going to invite all of our panelists back, please. So Morag and Chenine, do join us. And questions are coming through in the Q&A. Thank you so much. I'll try and get to as many of those as I can. We've got about half an hour or so. But just to kick off with everyone, I'm really interested in this question of why craft? Okay, because You know, we work with, you know, placemakers, work with performers, with artists, with fashion designers, with architects, with visual artists, with musicians, with the whole gamut, right? But we're having this conversation in the context of Collect, the International Art Fair for Contemporary Craft. So what is it that's special about craft in the built environment? Maybe Chenine, I might ask you to kick off with that one.
Yeah, I think for me, it's about the skills that people bring when they work with their hands. And something really beautiful and distinctive about it. I think also what I see in Coventry is there's a rich landscape of craft that goes on in our communities. You know, lots of people make with lots of different types of materials. But also I think from our new communities that are recently arriving in the city, this is one of the key things for them as well. This is their primary art form. And I've really loved seeing how the city council and even some of the designers and architects working around the city have really sought out those different communities and the craft of those communities to integrate it into the look and feel of the city. And I suppose for me, when we're thinking about creating that look and feel and dressing the city, really bringing the place to life using different materials and colours. You know, thinking about the cathedral that we talked about earlier, the great, you know, the work that's been done in there with glass, for example, some extraordinary craft on show, and tapestry. You know, materials are a big thing for Coventry as well. And so starting to see those in the fabric of our city is really important for me. And I think it's also how we bring those communities into that world. You know, someone asked a question around co-design and co-creation. It's a big part of the work we're doing in Coventry is about, you know, getting people involved, you know, building a program that starts on the ground and builds up rather than it gets flown in from somewhere else. And there's something really vital and important about communities being involved in this and co-designing this with designers and architects. And you've heard from the work that Morag's doing, that she's absolutely working on the ground with people, with artists, communities, so that we make this something special and make sure people have ownership of it.
Right, thank you. So there's that thing of ownership, and there's the thing about craft being being tangible and practical, and you can literally and metaphorically grasp it. Morag, can I bring you in for some reflections on this?
Absolutely. I mean, the majority of my work, I work with communities to build the work together, because it's really that sense of belonging. I think for too long, all our high streets have been taken away from us with the big chains, with, you know, all our cities really. And we haven't been allowed. When I think I did a hoarding in 1993, a bright colored thing in the street, and it was put in the paper that it was really obscene because it was too colorful and you weren't allowed to put things in the street. So the moment we were allowed to get out as artists and designers and make into the street and make things, and then to make things with other people. So if you're in a person's, if you're in a group, you know, in a community, in a neighborhood, why should somebody come in and just stick something in there because they think it's good or because somebody else above them has told them that that's right? You need to actually talk with the people, listen to people, get people involved, and different things mean different to everybody. You know, you have to make these connections and you have to make work that's valuable and will, and then it stands the test of time. Often people who hate the process in the beginning really, really are the people who love it at the end, you know. And everybody can, if you work with people, you find their strengths. So different projects I work in, I might work with a poet to get the words, and then we'll do the typography together, and then we might paint everything. So I think it's about absolutely getting people to own their own cities and feel like it belongs to them, and then they will care for it as well.
Fantastic, thank you. I think there's some really brilliantly phrased questions coming through, and I'm trying to I'm in stereo listening to you, Morag, and then reading these questions. And I think you've kind of answered a couple of these brilliantly phrased questions, but I'm just going to read them out because they are fantastic. One is saying, how do we ensure that true craft within the fabric of our cities remains authentic and delightful so that the craft bandwagon, often jumped on for short-term monetary gain, doesn't devalue the greater long-term good? So something about sustainability there, you know, as in sustained long-term vision. And then the second one, which is saying, much evidence that our environment directly affects us in our quality of life, our capacity to heal. And as you're saying, Morag, any new intervention also offers the potential to be the start of a meaningful dialogue with locals. So co-design and advocacy can be bedfellows. So this is a question about agency and evidence saying that agency and community can reduce health inequalities. So I'm interested in any perspectives on that, on the well-being aspect. Any insight into that, Chenine or Morag? And Caitlin, I'll bring you in a moment.
Well, I mean, when you've gone through the process of making things with people and you realise what their priorities are as well and what they want, and that you listen and you make those things happen, the well-being, you know, I can't really explain. You can see it in front of you, the right. richness that it can give to people when they're part of it. And I don't know, Chenine, can you go from there? I'm getting too
I would agree with what Morag's saying. I mean, we've just been doing this fantastic project across the city called Window Wonderland in communities. We created packs for people so that they could think about how to design and make installations for their windows and light them up at night. And it's been so extraordinary seeing the amount of creativity pouring out of people. And I think it's clearly everyone has a little bit more time on their hands, maybe everybody's at home. But I think that agency, that way in which, you know, people can come together, the way that art and maker culture brings people together, it's an extraordinary thing. And that can only be good for your health and well-being. It's why we're doing a city of culture, because actually, you know, we are a very working class city. You know, we have real struggles. It's a difficult place to live. You know, like many other cities, there are lots of issues. But actually, art is about creating soul, food for the soul. And the more people can participate in that, take part in that, build that, create that, the better their soul's going to be and the healthier and happier they're going to be.
Beautiful. Yeah, it's very empowering, isn't it? It's so empowering to people.
Yeah, very empowering.
It really is. And it brings us together. And of course, through this year of lockdown and isolation, that's what we're yearning for, is to be reconnected to ourselves, to each other, and to the environment around us. I'm struck that John Timpson of Timpson's, who of course did a review for the government only 2 years ago on the high street, was talking exactly of this yesterday morning when he was reflecting on those trailed budget announcements. And he was really talking about the reimagination of the high street as a community hub, that we still need, even if we're not shopping on the high street, we're going to need those high streets as places to connect with each other and share joy, actually. I'm going to bring in Caitlin on a slightly different but adjacent topic. Sarah has asked Caitlin. She's interested on Brookfield properties. How did you first start your art strategy and why? She's saying it's great to see examples of public work, but we have to acknowledge that public funding for such projects might be more limited in the world of COVID and Brexit. And here's the key question, Caitlin: how can we encourage more private investment in the way that Brookfield has invested in craft? And how do we illustrate the value of craft projects across the country? So just a little question there, Caitlin.
That's a three-parter. I can start as to why Brookfield started the arts program, and this goes back, 30 years ago. I was not there at that time, but I was started in, out of our New York office. Obviously, I'm from New York as well, and we started redeveloping a project in Lower Manhattan, and really saw an opportunity. We had a huge public realm, so really saw an opportunity there to activate that space. So started to work with an organization that has then become Creative Time, which is very big in the States. And that was kind of the first taste of Brookfield's entering into putting culture first in our public realm and making that free and open to the public. So kind of fast forward, that is ingrained, or global company, and that is now very much a part of our strategy down to like day one. You know, how can we infuse this space with culture, with green space, you know, places that people really want to be in our city, since we have the ability to really impact and shape cities. So that, I think, is part of the reason, honestly, I work for Brookfield and started working for Brookfield, because I thought it was very interesting how they were a private company who's funding free public art. How can we encourage more companies to do so? You know, I think a lot of companies are really understanding how important this strategy is to reinvigorating our cities. I sit on the Culture and Commerce Task Force for the City of London, the Square Mile bid. You know, we're very involved in the Culture Mile. And there is more and more every day, like, appetite for all kinds of businesses to infuse culture and craft into their day to day, because they're really starting to see how important it is to mental health, wellness, sustainability. You know, there's just so much there when, you know, just to kind of walk around a city center and see that arts and culture. I mean, it really changes your day. And I think that corporate support is really important, and we talk about it a lot, but I'm starting to see more and more other businesses talking about it as well. And I think the way that we really try to maintain that authenticity is to work with organizations such as Crafts Council, the Culture Mile, you know, artists that really understand the communities in which we are at, so that we're making sure that it really speaks to the communities in which we're putting these things. You know, we're not just pulling an artist from somewhere and, you know, placing it in the middle of a city center. We're really speaking to the community and our community leaders as to what will benefit the community the most. And that's really kind of how we push that strategy forward, if that makes sense.
Mm-hmm. No, that's a really comprehensive answer, succinct and comprehensive. So thank you, Caitlin. Well done. I'm going to take us on a slightly different tack, and I'm going to try and combine a couple of questions. There are loads coming in. Thank you. We're definitely not going to be able to get to all of them, but I'm going to do our best. So John Makepeace has said very rightly, crafts are the source of our traditional industries, and contemporary crafts have the potential seed to be industries of the future. Couldn't agree more, John. And I'm going to link that statement with a question which is really about making rather than craft in the public realm. So someone has said one of the issues in city centres is that they're underused these days. How can we make craft the thing that actually allows people to engage? So not just from the point of view of making it look nicer, but I think what this questioner is getting at is the experience economy and of a revitalised high street where there's making happening that might be professional making, to bring in John's aspect of industry, but also might be a chance where people can just get in and have a go. We have very little chance to make these days in schools and so on. So who would like to answer that? Chenine? Caitlin, and then Morag, and then Chenine.
I can touch on it. I mean, I know I spoke more to the visual side of things, but we are definitely seeing more of a trend of putting makers in these city centers, as you see kind of the evolution of retail and like what's kind of going on in the retail sector. You know, there's more space, I think, available for people to be creative. I know we're very interested in that. We've done a lot of work around makers in our spaces. We've done also working on some workshops for our occupiers to make things as well in the space, which I think is really, we've had a lot of excitement towards that as well. I don't want to take up all the time, but I think that's really exciting piece of how the cities will come back after lockdown.
Thank you, Caitlin. Morag, you wanted to jump in too?
I live above the shop. My studio, I live in Hoxton. But to be honest, I know there's been the pandemic, but I am having to rethink it because the rates are so high. In 10 years, my rates have been raised from 7,000 to 18,000 or something, you know, and that makes it sort of unviable. So I do actually think councils, if you really want to have that mix of people really not just visiting or doing workshops or something, but absolutely being embedded in communities, in particularly somewhere like Hertford Street, it's spelled with an E and I must say Hertford Street, particularly like Hertford Street, where there's a lot of smallish shops, you know, and often when you look up, sometimes the spaces at the top aren't even used, you know, they could come and live in those spaces and that would bring food, maybe street food, and it brings a whole different community. But unless something is, and maybe that's being done, but not that much, unless something is restructured, that has and makes it more possible for artists and makers to actually live and work on site in the middle of places, I think it's going to be hard to have true authenticity of makers in these city centres.
Completely. I think the business rates issue is a huge one. I mean, it's one that I think people across the board and across the political spectrum actually are knocking on Rishi Sunak's door saying this is a huge issue. I mean, certainly for cockpit and cockpit makers, one of the joys of cockpit is that as well as being a social enterprise, we're registered as a charity, which means that then we don't have to pass on business. We protect our makers from their business rates, basically. They don't pay them. And it makes such a difference. So, you know, that makes all the difference between having a viable business and in the middle of a city and not.
Absolutely.
Chenine, we're kind of rapidly running out of time. So Chenine, over to you. Making on the high street.
Yeah, I suppose I just want to say that there's a massive piece of work to be done, and it's really important that it's done now as we're starting to really kind of reimagine, rethink, you know, how we're going to come out of this pandemic and what the important things are in life. And having artists in our city centres, makers, crafters, you know, the whole gamut of artists, we need them in our city centres, and we've got to move away from city centres being about money and the economic economy being solely about the amount of money we make. You know, we've touched upon it. It's about experience. It's about health and well-being. And what we get when we bring artists and makers into our city centres, give them a home to live and work from, give them space to have craft fairs and gallery spaces, we start to see a whole vibrancy in our city centres, which drives our economy. And so we've got to stop thinking about how much money we can get per square foot. and move it on to actually what's important and what we're trying to achieve and the health and well-being of our citizens. And there's a big piece of work to be done, but we've been working really closely with our business improvement district, and they've been so wonderful. They've really understood the value of culture and art and craft to our city centres. And I was involved with the Mary Porter's pilots a number of years ago when I worked for the Mayor of London. And that was really about thinking about how do we diversify the offer on our high streets and in our city centres. And this is what we've got to try and look at now. And we need to be lobbying our local authorities and our business improvement districts and the people that run our high streets to really say, look, this is a time to reset our values. This is the time to do it. The artists are there, they're waiting, and they can really help us to reimagine the future of our high streets.
Fantastic. Thank you, Chenine. We've only got 5 minutes left. So I just want to pick up on something which is someone in all of these brilliant questions has said, can we save and share the questions? I can't promise that we can do that because I'm not from Crafts Magazine or the Crafts Council, but I'll definitely ask whether we can do that. And maybe Malaika can pick that up at the very end. And certainly there's a huge amount of food for thought for Crafts Magazine's July-August issue. And I just want to say, because there isn't going to be a chance to read out all of these questions, but just to say that they're coming in from right around the country. I can see Liverpool, I can see Dorset, I can see Sheffield, I can see Blackburn, you know, we've Creative Lancashire, Ed is here. There are people from right around the country. This is a huge conversation. We could have a whole conference on this very topic. I'm gonna have to wrap up and hand back to Malaika in a tick. So I just want to say a huge thank you to our three panelists, Chenine, Caitlin and Morag. A big thank you to you, our audience, for joining us and for sending in so many brilliant questions. Thanks to the Collect team and to Crafts Magazine. I'm going to say a few plugs. Subscribe to Crafts if you don't already. Take a look at the Coventry City of Culture programme. Remember, it starts on the 15th of May, and there are some amazing announcements that were made this morning. Brookfield Prize, keep an eye out for Anna Ray's exhibition in Bishopsgate later in the year. Look out for Morag's work on Hartford Street. And finally, Collect continues on Artsy to the 24th of March. There are 32 international galleries. There are over 400 artists from over 35 nations around the globe. Go and enjoy it. Go and buy. Thank you very much. And over to you, Malaika.
Thank you so much, Annie, for sharing that so brilliantly, and to all of our panelists for sharing such interesting insights into their own work and all their thoughts on craft in our cities in general. I can't wait to see playfulness, mischief and imagination, to borrow Chenine's words, emerging in Coventry and hopefully in all our cities. And some more new London fabulous from Morag. And also, of course, enjoying that exhibition at Brookfield Properties later this year. Like Annie says, that has given us so much food for thought for the issue. And it makes me really excited to put it together. So thank you all again so much for your time. And thanks for joining us this evening to all the audience. Good night.